The 1960s were a decade of change for the country and for the Bears. Coming off a championship season in 1963, Chicago needed new stars. In 1965, two players who would define Chicago football came into Papa Bear's fold. From the University of Illinois came linebacker Richard Marvin Butkus.
Give me 18 inches of daylight. That's all I need.
And from the University of Kansas arrived running back Gale Eugene Saves, the Kansas Comet. And his groundbreaking and game-breaking talent shined like a supernova. Dick Butkus was in a world of his own, the most ferocious defender of his time. One was silky smooth, the other a bit rough around the edges. For most of a decade, these two players defined the new generation in the NFL.
Shift 44 to a 56 stack, pow. Watch the play action, let's go.
Dick Butkus was both feared and revered by his peers.
I call him a maniac, stone maniac.
I don't understand it. I don't understand why they say things like that.
He was the greatest intimidator ever played football.
You had to overcome the mystique. It was almost like an odor. He exuded a kind of a presence.
Roses are red and violets are blue. If you've got any sense, you'll keep Butkus away from you.
He was an animal, and every time he hit you, he tried to put you in the cemetery, not the hospital.
I'm not sure. I think Butkus ate him.
If you remember, Butkus grunted a lot and growled a lot when he was back up the line. And we sent this rookie center in to play for us, and the first time he came off, his eyes were about like this. He couldn't believe what he was hearing from Butkus. Butkus had him intimidated. He hadn't even blocked him yet.
You play the Bears, and I've heard it myself from different people, is that they better get ready, you know, and that's all the respect that I need. If I was an animal, jerk, ass, or whatever, I didn't care.
He came to play, and it probably made me a better football player by competing against him in practice because he was tough.
About the only story that I can recall that really got my attention was that after a game, no matter what the weather conditions, he never took a bath. He never took a shower after the game. That he just went in front of his locker and would lie down and lick himself.
Is that true? Makes a great story.
Yeah. I don't know if it's true or not.
But that's a pretty good story. We'll leave it a little question mark there.
You can tell when a guy's going to be a great linebacker by his attitude. He's got it. You knew that Butkus had it right from the beginning. Butkus was tough. The name, it fits. You don't want to put a nice guy over there playing defense. You look for that attitude that the great ones have, and Butkus had it from the beginning.
A knee injury shortened his brilliant career, yet he has a bronze bust in the Hall of Fame and remains the gold standard of linebackers.
See that guy right there?
What?
You know who that is, huh?
Right there?
Yeah.
Who was that?
Dick Butkus.
Oh, yeah.
Dick Butkus. He was bad, man.
Yeah.
He was nasty, boy. He was nasty.
I stand before you with deep humility and pride. I'm proud of Chicago. And I'm proud to tell you that when I played for you, I gave it the very best I could.
Another of Papa's Cubs gave it his best alongside Butkus. In fact, Gale Sayers, in his rookie year, turned in perhaps the greatest single-game performance of all time. On a muddy field, Sayers streaked through the San Francisco 49ers for a record-tying 6 touchdowns.
I knew where I was going and they didn't. It was just, you know, one of those days you like to relive over and over again. One of those days that happens once in a lifetime.
The game capped a season in which Sayers set a rookie record with 22 touchdowns.
I didn't know that six touchdowns was tied the record. I didn't know that. I just did it. It was, you know, a great game.
It's perhaps the most indelible memory of Sayers. No fan will forget Sayers' single-game domination. Choosing a single Sayers run as the best is almost impossible. But one in particular stands out in number 40's mind.
The run that I made in 1967, against the Baltimore Colts. I go around the right end, come back to the left end, and see a little gap, and go up the middle. Boom, for about a 65-yard touchdown. That, you know, signifies Gil Sayers. That run, you know, I just enjoy seeing it.
In only 7 years, Sayers created an enormous catalog of runs that are a joy to see.
I had the quickness, you know, and the ability to see a hole and get there. Usually when I cut the next step, I was almost going full speed again. I just had that ability to do that.
His ability to elude tacklers was no joke and elicited admiration from all who saw him.
I thought I saw him an amoeba-like, or paramecium, split into two things, and the defensive people went at the wrong one.
He's a God-given talent, you know, no doubt about it.
I had great peripheral vision. There's no doubt about that. I could see everybody on the field, and so I knew where to run, where to cut. In the same way, I had a feel for where people were, because I know many times, many runs, when I want to look at films, there'd be a fella coming from my blind side, and no way I could see him, but I could feel him.
And he gave me a fake like this here, and my body went one way, my mind went the other way, and something happens to your motor when that happens. It's hard to explain, but my legs went limp, and I had nothing left. But the only problem he made was he went one too many fakes, and came right back into me, and I hit him and knocked him down. He said, "Nice tackle, Floyd." And I want to say, I couldn't even tackle if I wanted to. You ran into me.
In 1968, Sayers ran into a season-ending injury that put his career in jeopardy.
They say that once you get a knee injury, you should think about quitting, because a running back very rarely comes back from the type of knee injury that I had. I wanted to prove that one could come back from a serious knee injury within a year. They say so many times, well, it takes 2 years, it takes 3 years to come back. I want to prove that you could come back, and as I said, I had one of the worst knee injuries ever.
When he returned, he was a different runner, unable to rely on talent alone.
People play with broken ribs, fingers, whatever it may be, but they never shed a tear. They went out there and played.
It was his will that propelled him to his second 1,000-yard season in 1969. Cemented his place in Chicago history, and carried him all the way to the Hall of Fame.